Nice day, isn't it? Talking about the weather in California was always a bit drab because it never really changes. But I've been spoiled. After moving abroad, I find myself very dependent on weather predictions. Such a mundane thing and yet so immensely important. Accurate weather predictions are a perfect example of the progress enabled by the computer. I script this while watching the rain outside. In this video, we explore how the computer revolutionized the weather forecast. In the beginning, for thousands of years, weathermen's attempts to predict the weather were more art than science. The ancient peoples, like the Greeks and Babylonians, tried to read patterns in the stars or clouds. Like, if the halo around the moon is black-colored, then there will be rain and floods in the coming month. The ancient Chinese tracked weather conditions too. And though they largely believed that bad weather was because the ancestors were angry at us, they also recognized that the clouds came from water evaporating into the sky. And then there was Aristotle. In 340 BC, he wrote the book Meteorology, the oldest and most influential book on the topic. It's because of this book that we call it Meteorology. Despite the title, the book also covers water, physics, and the stars. Aristotle split the world into four elements, earth, wind, fire, and water, and the four are arranged in spherical strata interacting with one another. For example, he stated that east winds are warmer than west winds because the sun originates in the east. Despite occasionally veering into the supernatural, people appreciated the book's methodical and generally consistent approach, and it remained the cornerstone of Western meteorology education into the 1600s. I don't know what that says about human progress. In the 1600s, new tools, observations, and theories began to emerge in the West. You have people like Galileo inventing new tools like the thermoscope, a predecessor of the thermometer, and Evangelista Torricelli, Galileo's student, whose work on atmospheric pressure eventually led him to invent the barometer. In 1686, Edmund Halley, yes, the same guy who predicted the movement of Halley's comet, read his friend Isaac Newton's work on the second law of motion and was inspired. He published a theory that the sun's energy warmed air at the equator, causing it to rise. This left a gap that colder, denser air from higher latitudes rushed in to fill. Thus, we have the trade winds that sailors around the world have relied upon for centuries. Another notable model was the carbon dioxide model forwarded by John Tyndall. He discovered that certain gases like water vapor, carbon dioxide, and ozone absorbed heat well and parlayed that into a global model of the world's climate. Volcanoes release more carbon dioxide, which warmed the earth. Carbon dioxide is then removed from the air through various sinks like plant photosynthesis, cooling the earth. These types of models are known as conceptual models, called as such because they are formed from broad, sweeping generalizations, the same way internet gurus forecast geopolitics. These conceptual models, accented by the occasional analog model based on globes of hot water, dominated in these years. In the 1800s, improving tools and data collection allowed people to make better educated guesses about weather conditions and their forecasts. In 1854, the United Kingdom founded the Meteorological Department of the Board of Trade of the United Kingdom, or the Met Office. This small four-person department started off by delivering weather reports collected at 8 a.m. from weather stations around the island, sent via telegraph. 5 years later, a steam clipper called the Royal Charter was smashed against the cliffs due to a powerful storm. About 450 people died, a horrific tragedy. The same storm is estimated to have taken another 350 lives. The Met Office's founding director, Robert Fitzroy, who once captained the ship that brought Charles Darwin around the world, heard about this and approached Parliament with the goal of issuing storm warnings for mariners, and then later the public. However, Fitzroy's forecast methodologies, based on data collected from 32 weather stations, were often heated but not always accurate. Criticized for his non-scientific methods, Fitzroy fell into a deep depression and killed himself in 1865. A committee led by Francis Galton, Darwin's half-cousin, polymath, and the originator of eugenics, found that the Met Office had strayed from its main mission of just reporting the weather and ended its forecast reports for the next 13 years. In the second half of the 1800s, a set of immortal theorists began crafting the laws of thermodynamics, a fundamental principle of science today. In laying out the principles of transferring energy and heat, the laws of thermodynamics represented the final piece of the atmospheric puzzle. The first head of the American National Weather Service was a man named Cleveland Abba, whose badass nickname was, quote, Old Probability, end quote. After spending his early years doing astronomy, he pivoted to the weather, and later he would write that, quote, meteorology is essentially the application of hydrodynamics and thermodynamics to the atmosphere. He was right. A few years later, at the start of the 1900s, the Norwegian physicist Wilhelm Bjerknes took seven variables, pressure, temperature, density, humidity, and three components of velocity. He then took several fundamental equations of motion and energy, like Newton's law of motion, the three fundamental hydrodynamic equations of motion, collectively known as the Navier-Stokes equations, they describe the motion of viscous fluids, and the laws of mass continuity, a fundamental principle of fluid dynamics, stating that a fluid's mass stays the same as it transits through a system, as well as the equations representing the first and second laws of thermodynamics, though he probably would have been better served if he substituted out the second law for the continuity law of water. Anyway, Bjerknes smashed these together like a casserole to get a thing capable of describing how mass, heat, energy, and momentum all interact within an atmospheric system. He wanted to use these equations for a two-step strategy he called rational forecasting. Rational forecasting first started with a diagnostic step where you collected data on the atmosphere. Then that data is used along with the equations in a prognostic step for projecting for the weather to get a forecast. This approach had promise, but there was a problem. His equations did not have closed form solutions, meaning that we cannot solve them using algebraic formulas, variables, constants, and arithmetic operations, the works. Instead, you tried to solve them graphically. You took graphs of variables, applied the equations to them, and then used that to end up with new graphs representing forecasts. This required intense computational power that simply did not exist. Bjerknes, like Abba, saw no way to use his methods in practice. 10 years later, in 1922, a rather eccentric English scientist at the Met Office named Lewis Fry Richardson published the book Weather Prediction by Numerical Process. Richardson had been inspired by Bjerknes' work as well as that of astronomy, which used simple principles to successfully chart out the position of planets years in advance, forecasting things like eclipses. He wanted to do the same for the weather. Never mind that the movement of the planets were based on simple geometric relations, while the weather depended on intensely complicated webs of mechanics and thermodynamics. Richardson came to believe that we can take a snapshot of the atmosphere at a certain point of time. For example, collecting data on atmospheric pressure, velocities, temperatures, in grids delineated by various heights, longitudes, and latitudes. Then we can mathematically advance that snapshot into the future. He began his work in 1913 while running a weather observatory in the southern uplands of Scotland. His work continued through World War I, where he served in an ambulance unit in France as a conscientious objector. To see if his equations worked, he took two grid boxes over the British Isles for May 20, 1910, and manually calculated, with only a slide rule and a five-place logarithm table, the atmospheric pressure 6 hours later. He did the math right. Much later, a computer got similar values, but the predicted result, though, quote, directionally correct, end quote, as my teacher in high school liked to say, was off by 150 times. This was for two reasons. First, he used an incorrect method to estimate the rate of pressure changes, meaning a flawed data input. The second reason I will get to later. Richardson nevertheless published this disappointing result, which was brave. His failure discouraged generations of people from trying his approach again. But today, Richardson is remembered as a spiritual founder of numerical weather prediction. He later became a respected economist and statistician. So what is it about these equations that make them so hard to solve? What follows is my attempt to answer this. If I fail, then laugh at me in the comments. As I earlier mentioned, these equations are too hard to work out by hand. They have multiple variables and describe continuous changes that are non-linear, meaning that the line is not straight. Examples. Let us look at the momentum equation of fluid dynamics. It tells you the changes of a fluid's motion and velocity in space over time. This equation is non-linear. For example, velocity here has three directional components, and the equation includes terms where each one of these components is multiplied by its own or other components' derivatives. This indicates that changes in a fluid's velocity depend on the velocity itself, making the behavior somewhat chaotic and the equation very difficult to solve. This equation is also non-homogeneous, meaning that it is influenced by external forces that are independent of the fluid's velocity. For example, pressure gradients, Coriolis effects, or others, which are mentioned in this equation. This makes it very, very difficult to solve. Because we cannot solve this equation by analytical means, what we can do is approximate a solution, meaning breaking up the time and space continuums into a grid of finite points. This changes the equation so that now we can solve for the time plus one increment scenario. Remember, I promised to explain the second reason why Richardson's numbers did not work. He had chosen too large of an increment for the time plus one increment scenario, 6 hours. That was too long. You cannot travel too far ahead in a single time step, or else the equations destabilize, producing very faulty data. This concept is known as the Curran-Friedrichs-Lewy criterion, and it literally did not exist when Richardson did his work. It was first published in 1928 Germany by Richard Curran, Kurt Friedrichs, and Hans Lewy. Anyways, this was just one small part of the whole arsenal. Think about that. So any attempt at a daily weather report with current resources can only be completed long after the weather event in question had passed. In his book, Richardson wrote that he needed 64,000 human calculators, saying in the preface, "Perhaps someday in the dim future, it will be possible to advance the computations faster than the weather advances, and at a cost less than the saving to mankind due to the information gained. But that is a dream." Due to these challenges, most weather forecasts through World War II continued as they had been since the days of Fitzroy, pattern matching on maps. These maps are special maps. They were compiled using temperature, humidity, pressure, and cloud data collected via aircraft, ship observations sent via pigeons, UK weather stations, and even broken German codes. Famously, the RAF meteorologist James Stagg saw a short-lived high-pressure system and accurately forecasted fair weather on the morning of June 6, 1944. Not super ideal weather, but good enough, thus allowing the D-Day landings to move forward. The Germans' weather authorities, whose maps lacked weather information from the British side of the English Channel, incorrectly forecasted that the storms would not let up for the next 2 weeks. Thusly, many German commanders, including Erwin Rommel, headed back to Germany, a badly missed absence. In 1946, John von Neumann set up the Electronic Computer Project at the Institute of Advanced Study, or IAS, in Princeton, New Jersey. Von Neumann, the man who knew everything, was of course aware of Richardson's work. He knew that accurate weather forecasts held immense practical value, reflecting upon the immense work done forecasting the weather during the war. And having been in central Germany in the 1920s, when the Curran-Friedrichs-Lewy criterion was published, von Neumann also knew one of the reasons why Richardson failed. So he backed out the computational requirements to make Richardson's work feasible, probably while having breakfast or something, and concluded that the IAS computer can do it. So in 1948, he got US Navy funding to establish a meteorology project within the Electronic Computer Project, led by Jule Charney. The project originally wanted to follow Richardson's work, splitting the world into grids, then computing the transfers of energy and mass between those grids. But it quickly became clear that this was not feasible. The Curran-Friedrichs-Lewy criterion dictates that the time step varies inversely with the speed of the fastest moving phenomena. With the weather system, those would be high-speed gravity waves, a fancy term describing waves rapidly rippling vertically or horizontally through the atmosphere, causing distinct cloud patterns as they go, kind of like the outwards traveling ripples in a pond after a rock is thrown into it. Per the criterion, these waves would have forced a time step far too short for the computer to handle. So, using a powerful tool called scale analysis, Charney developed an approximation that filtered out these gravity waves due to their perceived unimportance to large-scale weather phenomena like big winds or pressure changes. The resulting quasi-geostrophic system reduced the old equation's many variables to a more mathematically manageable one. The system remained in use as late as the 1980s. In 1950, von Neumann's IAS computer was still in development, so they turned to the famous 30-ton vacuum tube-based ENIAC computer. In April 1950, the ENIAC ran numerical weather forecasts for 4 days in 1949 for a grid in the middle troposphere. Programming back then was painful. You no longer use cables and plugs to program the ENIAC. They updated it in 1948 to let you input stored programs using IBM punch cards, but it was still unreliable and quite slow. Each 24-hour forecast took 36 hours to calculate, and the forecast results were seen as, quote, uniformly poor, end quote, though the January 30th forecast had some good hits. They sent copies of the forecast to Richardson himself, a nice gesture. He called them an enormous scientific advance on his own work, though his wife thought they were both off by pretty similar margins. Despite the inaccuracies, the published work attracted worldwide attention. Within 2 years, various government weather bureaus around the world acquired computers for themselves, one of the first major demand sources of such. By the 1960s, scientists successfully tackled the first reason why Richardson failed by improving the data input into the models. Today, we collect data through weather radars, aircraft, and thousands of weather stations on the ground and in the air. Satellites in particular have helped a great deal with their broad coverage. Combined with the rise of supercomputers like the CDC 6600, designed by the wonderful Seymour Cray, we were able to add sophistication back into the models. Weather forecast accuracies rapidly began to improve thereafter. Accurate weather forecasts save lives, and more compute has made these weather forecasts more accurate. Work done by a team led by MIT's Neil Thompson, which I have mentioned before, has shown this. Every 10 times increase in compute power cuts prediction error by a third of a Fahrenheit degree across all forecast windows. They attributed 73 to 94% of this improved accuracy solely to the additional compute power. It's another instance of Rich Sutton's bitter lesson. The models themselves have expanded beyond simple weather forecasting. We're able to use them to predict other patterns, for instance, predictions of wind-carried radioactive particles from Chernobyl. I am staggered by their sophistication and mind-boggling complexity, and I cannot imagine the decades of work that have gone into making them so powerful. I'll remember that next time I start to whine about the rain showing up at 3 p.m. rather than 4. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.